We're just sitting here listening to the crickets. Tropical evening. Star of Bethlehem in the sky. Meltdown of sanity going on in the world. Takeover by technocratic fascists in the world. People have simply lost their minds. Most people have, and so we're expecting something. We're expecting something right now. Absolutely, we are. There just simply isn't enough juice to hold interest in the world as far as what's going on. It's stale. It's stale. Very stale. The tabloid techno culture is just abominably stale. We need a spiritual boost, a spiritual jolt. Get our attention back to real religion, which is to focus relentlessly on insisting that God's final judgment rest upon us right now. This is the ultimate in wisdom. Completely saves you from this dream of time, this dream of a dress rehearsal for time. This existence is nothing but a dress rehearsal, an imaginary preparation for what we believe time would be like if it ever was, but it never will be. For it's just really a fantasy. Existence is really just an arrogant fantasy, the belief that we can change reality. Every last bit of our misery and suffering comes 100% from our own arrogance, actually. This is true of everyone. And so accepting God's final judgment upon us right now is the end of arrogance, isn't it? It's the end of arrogance. I mean, we say we let God decide what we are. Since God created us, why don't we let God decide what we are? Right? Wow. A lot of bugs. What's that one? A bee just came in. Hello, bee. Being. Hey. What do you want? It's dark. It's nighttime. It's 10:30 at night. Bees usually aren't flying around at 10:30 at night. Bees are very nice little creatures. They make the honey. Always eating honey. Well, maybe in the darkness, being arrives in this darkness. We don't expect it to arrive, right? We don't expect it to. It's so dark in the world right now. It looks like we've gone into this bottomless pit, and we don't expect any being to show up under such circumstances, and yet here is a bee. Whoops, where'd it go? It suddenly dropped off the. It dropped off here, and we don't expect being to show up. I don't know where it went. It disappeared somehow. Okay, well. Maybe that's what will happen. It's gone somewhere. It showed up for a little while and then dropped off the radar screen. Maybe that's what will happen now. There's a lot of Christians thinking, hey, it's rapture time. Could very well be. Could very well be. I don't know if it will be this year or next year or exactly what's going to happen, but something is going to happen either this year or next year. We're entering into the time of trials, tribulations, and trauma, and turmoil, and it's stale. The farce has just sort of run out of juice. You know, it just doesn't really have what it takes anymore. The world cannot really entertain us anymore. It's the same old circus. Same old circus. So perhaps in the darkness, somehow being will make itself known to us and will help prepare us for the next step. You know, how can we have a dream that is free of arrogance? Okay. How can we have a dream that's free of arrogance, and then ultimately we set dreaming down altogether? So we're watching, we're waiting, we're in a very intense period here. There's no question, this July 4th, I was shown this a year ago, that July 4th, this July, it is going to be super intense, and it should really become evident that we need to take a different look at ourselves, this dream, this world. We need to shift gears. Okay, this should be very evident. We need to shift gears. This is enough's enough. We didn't come here for this, so to speak. I mean, I got led here by like a Pied Piper trying to help, but also music, kind of like I follow the good music, thinking, that'll never let me down. Oh yes, it did let me down. Are you kidding? It led to this, all that great music of the 60s, 70s, and you know, late 50s, early 80s, led to this situation now. So that's not helpful at all. Fortunately, there's something better than music, which is these spiritual ideas. They're more compelling. I spend my time with these rather than with music, which is quite extraordinary for me, having been a music addict for so long. I was able to break the addiction, and because I found something more compelling. And when you find something more compelling, just like in music, if you find some act that you like that are just super great, you know, you spend your time listening to that, and you don't go back to this old stuff that now you listen to say, that's not nearly as good as this. You say goodbye to the old stuff, listen to what you really like. Same thing with this, the spiritual ideas. You say goodbye to the music, say, hey, you know, this, it's just, you're flat. It's flat, very flat, lacks depth. So you don't try to do both. You know, occasionally, when I'm really desperate, I might listen to a song or two, but by and large, I don't listen to any music anymore. Certainly don't play any music, don't compose any music. And because I found something way better, way more compelling, with real depth to it, you know, just awesome depth, endless depth. And we can have this by accepting the judgment of God, final judgment of God upon us right now. So having got this clarification, this really provides a grounding for being here. That being can, I believe being can show up now, and we know how to ground it here properly, because we know what the message is. We're not confused. I won't be confused. The message is accept final judgment of God upon us right this moment. That's the message, actually. Bring God back into the picture, okay? We're creations of God. This is not such some sterile situation. We are creations of God. So we're spirit. We're not bodies, we're spirit. We're free. We're still exactly as God created us to be. And so bring God back into the picture and say, God, I'm ready for your final judgment upon me right now. This is spiritual wisdom. Now, it seems like the world's impossible place to do this, but it's really continuity fear being projected out upon the world, actually. Because there are times where I gain my confidence and I'm not worried about what the world thinks at all. And if you project to the world that, you know, it doesn't matter what the world thinks, I'm fine, I'm great, I'm perfect, then I don't think the world will be such a problem. But when you have this continuity fear, you project this, like, I'm not sure I can handle this, and then project it out to the world, and then the world seems like, it feels like, I'm not sure the world can handle this, I'm not sure the world can handle this, they're going to react to it and dislike it, you know. So this is what happens when we project the continuity fear. But it's inevitable, really, because the continuity fear is there. But it's better to practice this full stop in the wow and just dissipate as much of it as possible. But when you're going really fast, it's difficult. Some gets projected, and you have to realize, oh, that's just projection. The world won't necessarily be totally against me. They might just ignore me. Say, yeah, who cares? So don't cave in to the feeling like the world's against you and you can't do it here and stuff like that. That's projected continuity fear for the most part. And just give yourself a chance to let that dissipate, gradually dissipate. Keep your poise. And I think the world is thirsting for some presence of being here, and so they can just turn their attention to that, because of this you know, world affairs and politics and celebrities and laws and just on and on stuff, just activism and everything. Yeah, we're tired of that. We're really tired of it. It's been going on my entire life, nonstop. I'm so tired of that. Just yearning for something better than that. We can do better than that. This is really a very, very low expression of what we're capable of, what's going on right now in the world. We can do way better than that. Can the technocrats really stop us? You know, not really. We're only stopping ourselves. So what to do is just keep on with your spiritual practice, this full stop on the wow. Just keep listening, hearing truth, let it be triggered by this and say, wow. Let the wow be triggered. And then let it wear off. And then trigger it again, let it wear off. Trigger it again, let it wear off. This is the way. Just keep triggering the wow and let it wear off. And each time we do that, you get deeper and deeper and deeper. It's like drilling a well. Finally, you hit water. Now, I've tried to pioneer a television station, radio station, internet, some way to enable us to stay occupied all the time with spiritual consideration. and not go to the television or not go to the internet sites that, you know, are lead you astray from all that. They're just, you know, how do we occupy our 24 hours, and, you know, some asleep and such and working, but how do we keep our mind occupied, properly occupied, is the question. Now, this path can be so stressful at times that resting is one way to occupy. I do that every day. I'm so tired. The stress is so extreme here that taking a rest is helpful. I tape, I rest, I tape, I rest, that kind of thing like that. But it can get a little, you know, how do you, can the intensity is so much that you can't spend, you know, entire day on this intensity. The wow factor gets too strong. So you have to give the chance for the wow to settle down. So what do you do then? Well, some people do art, some people do music, some people rest, some people eat, relax, some people watch a sporting event or something. Some people have a hobby, some people read a book, some people just kind of sit quietly, doing not much of anything. That's our challenge here in this world. This world is a challenge to use this world as a stepping off place into another universe, a different dream. That's why Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Let those who want a dream of arrogance, let them deal with the problem. So the dream of arrogance, what does that have to do with us? Jesus said, it has nothing to do with us. So let them imagine there's a tooth fairy god of this world that they're pleasing by staying in this world and trying to take care of it one way or the other. God is a true God, is not an author, an architect of worlds or universes. And they think that, you know, by staying with this world and continuing to try and make this their home, that they're pleasing some god or pleasing their own pride or whatever it is, their conscience or whatever. Well, let them do that. We've already accepted God's final judgment upon us. We don't need to engage in some dance with an imaginary tooth fairy god of this world, trying to please it and then displease it, or displeasing. Oops, let's, you know, you can always look at the world and say, well, maybe I'm pleasing to God this way, but in other ways I'm not so pleasing to God. And, you know, this whole idea of being pleasing to God, you know, this is the dream of arrogance. It's a dream of arrogance. And unfortunately, a lot of religion has gotten caught up in this. And of course, being pleasing to ourselves here, trying to, you know, like, hey, what can we do with this world? Let us, you know, this is arrogance. It's just all arrogance. Let those who have want a dream of arrogance, let them take care of the problems that arise. We're going beyond that. We don't need a dream of arrogance. We've repented and accepted God's final judgment upon us right now, which is, of course, judgment that we're absolutely perfect. Created perfect. There's no way we cannot be perfect. We can't mess it up. We don't have to try and please God. Once we realize there's absolutely no way we can ever mess it up, that will then really change our outlook. We think, well, why the heck then am I playing this game of trying to avoid messing up and messing up some and trying to fix the messing up? Well, what is that for? That's ridiculous. There's no way I can mess it up. We think we can mess it up. We're trying to identify the bodies. We'll say, "Hey, God, look, look, I'm just this little body here in this little world, a little ant. You don't need to be frightened of me. I can't mess anything up. What could I possibly do? I might cause some problems here in this world, but I can't mess you up." You know, we're frightened. We think our spirit can really mess it up with God. But when we find out we cannot mess it up with God, then why do we need this ridiculous charade of trying to pretend that we're so weak and incompetent and bound by time and space, process and form and all that nonsense? Just a dream. We cannot mess it up. Now Jesus has mentioned to me that some will wake up overnight. They'll go to sleep the next morning. They're awake. Awake to truth. So hopefully that'll happen. We're in the times now where we need that to happen. Just a tipping point is reached and continuity fears have been evaporated enough, and then just the fear of messing up is gone. The final judgment upon us is accepted. We can't mess up. We're perfect. Nothing we can. There's no way we can ever deviate from that, no matter what we do. And so that's it. And fundamentally, we have a different outlook. And once we realize that nobody can mess up, no one can mess up at all, then we have a different outlook towards everyone. So this outlook can shift overnight. Is possible. Yeah, why not? It has to shift sometime. I was depressed today, just looking through the internet, looking for signs of life anywhere, couldn't find any. Again, it's easy to get sucked into this world, and it doesn't mean that you're absolutely stuck. It doesn't mean that nobody's absolutely stuck. No one's really stuck at all. But you know, we probably shouldn't be Pollyannish about saying, "Well, just all it needs to do is a little breeze of divinity, and then people will just automatically set down their defenses." And I tell you, it doesn't seem to work that way. It doesn't seem to work that way. So realistically, those defenses are very confusing. And it takes a while to get used to not using them, not having them. It feels like a security blanket. So they won't necessarily just set all their defenses down. That's very unlikely. But there may be some, you know, success situations. I was looking to see, oh, that is the bee. It is on me. It is crawling on me right now. It's going to be crawling on my leg right now. Wow, let me see, what can I do? Oh, it disappeared again. Where'd you go now? Oh, there it is, over there. Okay, wow, just a minute. Get in here. Come on, B. Come on in here. Whoops. Come on in there. Come on. It doesn't want to go in there. Come on. Come on. Ha. It's a tough one. I cannot get it in here. Got it. Okay, I got it in this little bowl. It cannot. It cannot get out of there, so let it just relax. We have being now in a bowl. Now there's a little bowl here, and the bee is in this little bowl. It might come out of it. And I can't see. No, I cannot see. But, okay. Well, this is one of these bees that, you know, they are not able to fly anymore, or, this happens to bees when they get old. And so it's just sort of now just walking around. It flew in here, and that's his last flight. It's walking around. But to our advantage, huh? Because we have the bee being here with us in the bowl. Hello. It's unable to fly, is the thing. So that's, you know, but symbolically, we have the being has now come here into this world, and it's not flying off. It's not flying off. It's staying with us. It's kind of like divinity pretending, like, I can't leave here. I'm here for. I have to stay here for a while. Okay, let's have a nice place where you can stay, and that's great. Of course, the being can leave whenever it wants. It's just a dream. Dream appearance in a dream. So, I was prepared. I had this little bowl, and I was able to get it in the bowl, and now it stays with us for a while. And then when we don't need it anymore, out of the bowl, but actually would just say, oh, I can fly. Oh, I just forgot. I can fly, actually. Of course, this bee could fly if it wanted to. It's playing along with the dream of impermanence. Maybe, you know, keep in mind the bees are under enormous assault in this world. This is a sign of the times. The devastation of the bee colonies throughout the world. Well, bees, for me, honey, golden honey, they always stand for being. Sort of like a symbol of spiritual being. They collect the nectar, the pollen. They make beautiful, sweet honey, you know, and they pollinate everything and help everything be fruitful. And so bees are, you know, wonderful, and they're being absolutely decimated and destroyed by what's going on in the world, and nobody can quite figure it out. They say, well, it's a combination of all these different factors, and you know, it could be a spiritual thing. So we have a bee saying, I just can't. I've lost my way. I said, don't worry, you're here with friends. So, the important aspect of successful spiritual practice is giving it ample amount of opportunity, and don't shut it down so quickly. If you read a blog or something, you get something in print, it's very quick, and you, okay, da-da-da-da-da, okay, wow, got it, that's it. Okay, click on to the next thing. That doesn't really get the job done at all. You have to go way deeper than that. So the wows are very profound and just so shocking. You just, all you can do is just sit here, so shocked. That's the real path. That takes, you need to devote some chronological time to that. The bees. These bees, unfortunately, wander about like this, and then they just stop wandering and just lie there, and that's it. How to stay away from the news is the question right now, right? I have to do a better job at that. It's just I'm feel anticipating a breakthrough. Anticipating a breakthrough. So, kind of like, yeah, this is a time when it's so intense. We're anticipating something right now. So for some reason, I started paying attention to the news in a certain way, just to kind of verify that, okay, yeah, indeed, we're off and running right now, and we have fallen to an all-time low here, where truth is just absolutely mocked. And savagely attacked and mocked, and it's beyond belief. I mean, I nobody that grew up in earlier ages here can quite believe how far we've sunk and fallen. It just isn't. You know, it's easier to accept the judgment of God than it is to believe what's going on here in the world. I mean, it's just. It's tragic beyond belief. That folly is being celebrated. The incapacity to reason is being celebrated. That technocratic society is being seen as the highest goal, you know. This is just absolutely astonishing. How could we have fallen so far so fast? Well, we go back to the late Bronze Age, and it collapsed very fast. And it was termited somehow, you know, sabotaged. I'm sure they couldn't figure out how did this happen. Well, right now, we're, you know, historically, people will look back and say, how in the world did that happen? We fell so far so fast, it just doesn't seem possible. But if you live through it, you know it is possible. It's this relentless propagandizing by advertising and news and advertising. And then the constant politicization of everything and the constant generation of crises in order to then exploit the crises. And people are just like lemmings right now. They think that by celebrating insanity, it somehow is going to sanctify it. And the answer is it doesn't, which will be a very rude awakening for them at some point. It's not like a heroin addict thinking the answer to withdrawals from heroin is to take more. They think, of course, that's a no-brainer. Take more. Kick the can down the road. But there's no arrogance, no addiction like arrogance addiction, where you just keep kicking it down the road and you just you feel like you have to do it. Like you just can't face it. You just cannot. And you feel, when you feel like you're trapped and you have to, you just feel like it's the most unfair thing imaginable. Totally unfair. Being asked to accomplish the impossible to set arrogance down. But remember, it's actually arrogance that's trying to accomplish the impossible. So setting down arrogance is not arrogant. We don't have to accomplish the impossible. We have to accomplish the possible, which is, you know, just ask. Actually, it's easy. Ask God that God's final judgment rest upon us right now. It's really that simple. So it's extremely helpful to have the simplicity of salvation preached here in this world, because rarely is it ever preached in this world. And it's super helpful. If anyone can hear this, that is salvation is very simple. Simply insist that we experience God's final judgment upon us right now. That's all. That's all. That's it. Nothing more than that. There aren't any hoops to dance, to jump through. No dance we have to do. Nothing we have to do whatsoever. Judgment's already there. It's always been there from the very beginning of our detour into arrogance. So we just we insist that we experience God's final judgment upon us right this instant. That's the entirety of salvation. That's the whole thing right there. And this is a shock, because we realize we don't need any of the other teachings. We don't really need any of that. We just have to get to this. All efforts are just to get to this. And, you know, I don't know why I didn't see it before. I don't know why others have not seen it. And yet, there it is. There it is. Well, I do know why. I mean, you can't explain it, but we've done that in all the other videos, and it's left a record here of you know, the difficulty of getting there, but showing it's possible. And just so again, I insist that I experience God's final judgment upon me this very instant. I insist upon it. And there's nothing more to it than that. Nothing more to it than that. Everything else is just a sophisticated excuse not to do this. Or a not sophisticated excuse, just an excuse. Some are more sophisticated than others. Some will say, no, I'm really working on my spirituality. What do you mean? I can't accept judgment. Now I'm evolving. I'm getting better. I'm getting, you know. Stuff like that. That's just a sophisticated excuse. There's a lot of spiritualized excuses. And so we keep being delayed by those. Keep being delayed and looking at, oh, maybe I need to do that. Maybe I need to do this. And no, we don't need to do any of that. How are we doing here? It's still only 40 minutes about. That seems like longer. That's probably because I'm pretty agitated. And just trying to find, is anyone, can I find anyone on the internet, through the internet, if any feeling like somebody actually is really attuned? I is there anybody has gotten to this? You know, it doesn't seem like it, just because it's just absolutely simple. And the thing is, you can come into this world with this simple message, and I believe I did. But nobody is going to understand what the heck you're talking about, and so they insist on a bunch of complexity and are asking questions. And before too long, you lose sight of the simplicity of it. It is extremely difficult to bring this, the sheer simplicity of salvation, into this world. But once you do it, once you're able to do it, then you'll always be able to do it. Because this hellhole here is dedicated to not seeing the simplicity of salvation, to doing everything and anything but that. And so, of course, they'll say, well, no, you don't have it right. It's you've oversimplified it. It's all this other, you got to do all this other stuff, and you don't really understand. You know, you need to do this. That's what happens, right? You know, you don't really understand. It's there's a lot more to it than that. That's arrogance. So arrogance is a massive, massive defense system of saying all the stuff it needs to do. For what? God's already judged the dream of arrogance at the very beginning, judged the entire dream from the very beginning, and just said, none of it's true. God, my son is still exactly as I created him to be. It's perfect. And nothing will ever change that. So that's the final judgment on the dream of arrogance right from the very beginning. It was judged right from the very beginning, the totality of it. And so that's as simple as it can possibly get. So what people have trouble with here is that sheer simplicity. That is what they don't get. They don't get it. They don't get that there's only one thing to get. That's asked to experience God's final judgment upon them right now. That's it. Nothing more. Nothing more or less. That's it. And so sitting quietly helps one adjust to this. Otherwise, when you give the mind free rein, it will take off and start asking questions. And one question will lead to 10 more, and 10, those 10 more will each lead to 10 more. And you just get this exponential upsurge of thinking and thoughts and just overwhelming yourself. So, you know, if someone asks a spiritual question, there's only one answer. Sit quietly. And eventually, and practice full stop in the wow, and eventually the answer to that question will arise. And the answer is to accept God's experience, God's final judgment upon you this very instant. That's the answer. That's the answer you're looking for. That's the answer you're really looking for. And of course, any brilliant answer, if someone asks a question to that which is awake, the answer is going to be brilliant and enlightening, and it's going to shock you. It's going to shock you. And so if you haven't been practicing full stop in the wow and really good at it, the answer will overwhelm you, and then you'll feel attacked, and then you feel that someone's trying to undermine your truth, you know, by attacking you. It's too much, and then you feel like that whoever did that really doesn't want to talk with you or help you at all, and so then a rift occurs. So this is the problem with asking questions. It really ends up creating rifts. Whatever you need to know, sitting quietly will lead you to it, and ultimately leads you to the truth that all you have to do is experience God's final judgment upon one, and that's it. And just keep abiding in that, the sheer simplicity of it. So this sitting quietly, full stop on the wow, is the fastest way. It's the fastest way. And it really works. B is just, it can't really move anymore. It's on its back. It's trying to, there you go. What happens is they fall on their back. They fall on their back and then they can't get off their back anymore. It's able to do get off the back, so yeah. We don't want to fall on our backs, do we? We want to get off our backs, that is for sure. We're being backed into a corner here in this world. That's another use of backage. The ones that we thought had our backs don't have our backs. That's a feeling like, wow, whoops, they don't have our backs. So, this message has your back, and sitting quietly and enables us to absorb the shock of this message. This message is incredibly shocking. It's so simple. And we thought we needed to do something to be saved. And of course, we find out salvation is entirely by grace of God, but it's really by judgment of God, the judgment of God upon us. Ultimately, we don't even need the grace. The grace just leads us to the judgment. All we need is the judgment, which is that we're perfect. Never deviated from what we are. We never did. That's it. End of worries, end of concern. So truth will always be your sheer simplicity. Anything other than that is the dream of arrogance. And so we can hardly succeed as long as we keep reinforcing arrogance. It just doesn't work that way. So we must be very humble. We must repent. Repent, repent, repent. Means set down arrogance. That we need to do something. That's sheer arrogance. What God created perfect, what do we need to do in order to improve God's judgment upon what God created perfect? That is total arrogance, isn't it? The notion we need to do anything is nothing but arrogance. God created us from the very beginning is absolutely perfect. So what in the world do we really need to do? Nothing whatsoever. We cannot make ourselves perfect. We already are. God created us perfect. So we do have to ultimately come to the sheer simplicity of right nowness, of I'm experiencing God's judgment upon me, right, final judgment right now. That's the end of arrogance. That's the only way to end arrogance. So the absolute simplicity of it is a shocker. I say, no, my God, I could have done that all along. And I never really defended, or really wasn't never well defended against this at all. There's the wowness, like, wow, that I'm not defended against that. Holy cow. And then we just, then they have to say, well, that's okay. Let me not defend against it. Let me just accept it. That, yeah, that's fine. I can at any instant insist that I experience God's final judgment upon me right now. Any instant. Okay, so how can I be defended against that? I'm not really defended against it. That's a shock. That's a shock. And so instead of defending against this, oh my gosh, I got to figure out how to defend against this. We don't do that. We just sit quietly. Okay, this is super important. We just let them put our mind in neutral. We do not immediately go searching for a way to defend against this. We don't say, oh my gosh, that's horrible. I could insist that God's final judgment, that I experienced God's final judgment upon me right this instant. I could do that, and it would happen if I really insisted on it. Oh my gosh, that's awful. How do I prevent that? And then we get into this crisis management mode of trying to figure out ways to prevent it in our mind. This is what leads us astray. Instead, we just say, wow, okay, this is shocking. Very shocking. But I can do anything about it whatsoever. I'm just going to coast here for a while. That's it. I'm not going to do anything about it. Don't struggle with the struggle. Just get used to the shock of this fact. Wow, this is quite shocking. And I'm experiencing this right now, the shock of recognition. Defense against this at all. Never had any effective defense against this. I was all a house of cards. Wow. So once again, now it's just, yeah, it's losing its strength. Bee, wake up. Accept God's final judgment upon you, and the blessings will be showered upon you in a never-ending shower of gentle rain. Accept God's final judgment upon us. Yeah, accept it. I accept God's final judgment upon me. I accept the experiencing of God's final judgment upon me right this instant. I accept the experiencing of God's final judgment upon me this very instant. Again, super rare that this ever gets presented in a just completely simple way like this. I accept the experiencing of God's final judgment upon me this very instant. That's all that one has to ask for. That's the final prayer. And it's a testimony to the amazing defensiveness we've been able to weave of deception that took me like a lifetime to get to this, knowing that it's there but just couldn't find it. Yes, it's just truly extraordinary. So yes, may I insist that I already experience God's final judgment upon me right this instant. You can say, yes, I'm already experiencing God's final judgment upon me this very instant. Yes, I am already experiencing God's final judgment upon me this very instant. Yes, I insist that I experience God's final judgment upon me this very instant. Yes, I insist that I experience God's final judgment upon me this very instant. That's the assertion. Then we're going to do the already form. Yes, I know that I'm already experiencing God's final judgment upon me this very instant. At first, we'll be amazed that wow, this is so easy that no defense is really actually ever defended against this. This is a very, very severe shock. It was nothing but totally flimsy. Everything we've done is to defend against this is completely flimsy. We could always just go directly to this. All this indirection. We thought we had wandered off far away, but the fact was, it was always with us. Wherever we wandered, we could always turn to this instantly. So we never actually wandered away from it. Ever, no matter where we went, it was always with us. This is what's so extraordinary. The counter is going really slow for some reason. That's amazing. Maybe it's just the intensity. Carrying a being into a different dimension. The bee says, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? I'm losing my sense of being here. Oh my God. Well, we can go into a different universe, different dimension, different. We can experience God's final judgment upon us, and the blessings will be never ending, and we will be abiding in that judgment, that final blessing. Yeah, the endless blessing. That's the judgment. Endless blessings of perfection. Let's give a microphone in there. See what it sounds like. Still reverberating. It's like a breakthrough, an insight. It reverberates, and you know, it keeps reverberating, but it gets a little softer, a little softer, a little softer. And how are we at? We're at one hour. That's good. I insist on experiencing the final judgment of God upon me this very instant. I insist on experiencing the final judgment of God upon me this very instant. I insist upon experiencing God's final judgment upon me this very instant. I insist upon experiencing God's final judgment upon me this very instant. We're willing to spend a lifetime chasing after rainbows rather than say this. And for most, they never say it here. They just don't get to it. Just don't get to it. Most people think that dying is the final judgment, so all you have to do is die and they'll have it. That's not God's final judgment upon us at all. That we die? No, God's final judgment upon us is that we're absolutely perfect, exactly as God created us. Nothing's ever happened. We've never deviated from it at all. It's just been a dream. That's the final judgment, so. Bee is in the final throes. It just it doesn't take long, does it? It just cannot. Well, this is a very nice place for it. It's very clean. Sacred place. The final judgment is that we've never been born. Never been born. Never been born, we never died, we never deviated from our being that God created us as. We never deviated from the reality of our being as created by God. We never deviated from the reality of our being as created by God. Never. Never, 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 in spite of all our arrogant beliefs that we have. So, to hear the simplicity of it, it means we're extraordinarily tuned into it. That cannot be a bad thing. It has to be a very propitious development that we're tuned into it like this. So, we will continue here, and we know that this time is very intense. And this is, I think we're in the second of, almost the second of July. When you're seeing this video, it'll be the second of July. We're only 2 days away from July 4th. So, now for people of other countries, that doesn't mean any much from, you know, but it, in terms of the Jewish calendar, it actually means a lot. In terms of prophetic warnings, it means a lot. And in terms of world, I mean, there's a, you know, a huge alert in the United States about an attack on July 4th. And so, we're all, you know, on edge, and they arrested somebody already who was planning an attack. And it's a very intense time we're in right now, to say the least, where we've lost, you know, some the will to keep it all together and turn to truth. You know, turn to truth. We seem to have lost the will. We're lost in tabloid techno land. So remember, always keep pushing your practice longer and keep pushing it and just hang in there and keep working at it like we have done over these years. Preparing for the intensity of these times, knowing that the intensity of these times are here now. And it is, you know, the world has lost that loving feeling, that is for sure. We have, love has lost, basically. It seems that way in the world, hasn't it? The love of truth, the love of salvation. Instead, we're plunging into the love of the flesh. You know, we get tweets from people in high places saying, love wins or something. What? Love of the flesh wins. Yeah. Love of truth, love of salvation seems to be losing out here. But, not everyone is insistent upon losing opportunity. So, we will see Star Bethlehem. So fascinating. Perhaps it showed up after Jesus' birth in Bethlehem. It's long ago, now it's showing up here after Jesus has returned. Here, it is quite extraordinary. Quite extraordinary. I said Jesus returned May 1st here. He's back. And now we see the Star of Bethlehem. I certainly didn't see that coming. That's what the scientists call it, Star of Bethlehem. You know, some scientists better than others. That's, you know, I'm not pro or anti-scientist. Some scientists better than others. That's a good way to put it. Some is really great and some is really terrible. They love to name things and stuff like that. You know, they're just very peculiar. Science is very peculiar. But some is better than others. But certainly the lining up of Venus and Jupiter. Remember back then, the sky was crystal clear. All right? We didn't have this atmospheric contamination. And the stars just like shone like jewels, and the planets even brighter. And when you had a conjunction of Venus and Jupiter, and it was a really great conjunction, and the conditions were right, in that sort of sky that they were looking at, in the dry desert sky, I'm telling you, the stars just are like diamonds. That would have been a very, very significant and bright light in the sky right in the evening time like this before the other stars had come out to play. It would be the moon would be there likely, and then, you know, these planets and the rest of the stars, you couldn't see them yet, and so it'd just be this brilliant jewel-like, you know, light in the sky, and that very well could have been the Star of Bethlehem. And it's back right at this time right now, between the end of June and the 4th of July, which we have been told, the Holy Spirit has told us, this is a very significant time. There could be trouble on 4th of July. There very well could be trouble. We pray that there is not any trouble. Looks like the bee has passed on. It has stopped its struggles. Well, it passed away in a very good place, didn't it? Listening to this, the truth here. Or maybe it's just gone into full stop in the wow. Let's say prayers for the bee. Maybe this is a sign for the bee that the being, our attunement to being in this world, is coming to an end. It's been taken over by this tabloid technocratic society, and all the terrorism and all the agitation, etc., that the bees just can't take it anymore. And they're ready to shift dimensions, ready to shift universes. So again, Jesus is back. And this gives us extraordinary sign to what I've been saying, is that it's true. You see, this should start waking some people up. I said right off the bat, Jesus has returned. I experienced it. He said specifically, spiritually, he broadcast the world spiritually. And people are thinking, you know, that Jesus is going to broadcast over mainstream television. No, I don't think so. Jesus broadcast spiritually to the world, and I heard it in a dream. I was aware of it. Came down from on high, said, I am back. I'm here now, ready to relate with you. Ready to relate with you. So, who wants to relate? You know, he's back. And I said, okay, I will. May 1st, let's put it, May 1st, okay, he's back. And I've been saying that and saying that and saying that. Nobody said anything, you know, no response whatsoever. But now we have the Star of Bethlehem 2 months later. That should start triggering some people, say, whoa. We have the Star of Bethlehem after Jesus was born in this world, and now we have the Star of Bethlehem after Jesus has returned to this world. So, this is quite extraordinary. Quite extraordinary. Maybe people will start believing what I have to say. I absolutely feel that this is true, that Jesus did return. It was very unequivocal. I literally had the experience of relating, talking with Jesus. It was a very profound experience. And he said, I'm back. I'm here now. I've got my full attention on this world now. And here we go. I said, oh, great. And then the Star of Bethlehem shows up, and there's no mourning about it, no clue about that. Tremendous confirmation. Tremendous confirmation. Yeah, the bee has stopped moving. Well, he's just kind of softly pulsating there, but not able to move the legs or anything anymore. That's it. Now, Jesus said, you know, he's going to return when he decides to return, when it's right to return, when it's the moment, you know, it just, not planning, it happens with the right moment, automatically. So he said, don't try to figure out exactly when I'm going to return. I'll tell you when I return. Just be spiritually ready. So when I tell you that I'm back, you'll hear me and respond. That's all he, remember, he said, you don't know when the master of the house is returning. You don't know. Prepare, prepare, prepare. And that's what we've done here. We weren't trying to pin down a date for the return of Jesus. We just said, we know it's soon. We know it's soon. Let's just keep preparing, preparing. And when it happens, we'll be ready and we'll say, great. We'll go. Let's go with this now. We're able to go with this. So that's where we're at. That's where we're at now. He's been back for several months. And having an opportunity to adjust to it now. Having an opportunity to adjust. We've already had a couple of months to adjust to it. So we're well on our way here. Well on our way as we head towards the 2nd of July, right? We're into the 2nd of July now. Head towards the 3rd and the 4th. And the intensity should just increase to an extraordinary extent. And yet we have our practice here. It's already, we already have it. And so we can turn to it now at any moment. We can realize, wow, we're never without this. And it's never really covered up. And we've never been blocked at all. We've never been blocked at all. Never been blocked at all. Just, yeah. I insist on experiencing God's final judgment upon me right this very instant. So I'm not blocked at all. I've never been blocked from this. Never. God is not withholding it. You know, it's just my reluctance to accept it is the only thing. But it's right there. It's for, there for everyone. Let the being hear the vibration. Let the being hear the vibration. The pure tone. Perhaps a bee has never passed away in this way before in the history of the universe. Passing away in a Tibetan bowl, singing bowl here. Getting the full rites here of passing into the bardo. I mean, this may have never happened before. in the bottom of this bowl. The bee has found its, you know, its resting place, and it's receiving the vibrations here, helping carry it back into the unmanifest here. Being helped to be carried back into the unmanifest, our shifting universes, is being helped, getting the right vibrations for that. Yeah, I mean, it's possible that no bee has ever been given such an ending and a send-off before. It's a very fortunate bee to come into here right at this time, right this moment, doing while we're doing this taping. Knowing that this was the end, end times, it gets this royal send-off. It's here, it's a bit immortalized on this video, it's here present when we're giving out this profound spiritual truth, and it's receiving the vibrations from the bowl. So the end went quickly for it, didn't it? End times are liable to go very quickly, like this, very quickly. The symbology is taking place in the world now is quite extraordinary. There's one that people have missed, and that is the sign of the euro is actually very similar to the trident that was on the Malaysian Airlines and also on the Maserati commercial, etc., etc. The actual sign that of the euro currency is this like half moon like thing with two prongs like this, but you could see the two ends in the middle is like a trident. Actually, it's like a trident. Sudden, you know, disappearance of these planes, and sudden, you know, ultimately they crash, they go wandering off into the ocean somewhere. There's just so much symbology taking place right now. It's just off the charts. But what we're doing is, again, I insist on experiencing God's final judgment upon me right this instant, right this moment, this very moment. And Jesus tells us to keep, when we practice, keep practicing like that it's going to happen, that it's already happening. It's already happening. And just keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. And then it will happen for us. All right. So it's getting fairly late here. And the bee says that its time has come. And so we're going to wrap it up now. In the wowness of it, realizing, wow, it's so simple. I never was defended against it. And there's a tremendous wow. And just so we just absorb that. And continue our pace as fast as possible, because the situation in the world is now accelerating. It's out of control. It's just a full-on battle. I mean, it's absolute mayhem right now. this going on, really ideological mayhem. So we're going to continue our pace and outpace it. All right, very great. That's it.